This question is for Professor Dragan. What are some of the governing criteria that defines the transition in the robotic interpreting something as an obstacle versus something to be coordinated with?
Right. That's a good question. Right now, we're just saying that anything that's just part of the physical world, but that doesn't actually reason, right? So just as we call this a reflexive policy. So an object gets pushed around, it will react to that, but it won't make any decisions, right? So that's not an object that you need to coordinate with. You just need to model the consequences of your actions. Like if I start pushing this, it will move. That's fine. When you have other agents, meaning they're also, they have some objectives that they're approximately optimizing for. That's when you need coordination, because you have decisions being made on both sides. And the sort of the general formulation of the problem is this game theoretic kind of crazy complex thing. And so humans fall into that. I mean, I don't, other robots fall into that. And then beyond this, you know, you can think of pets and so on as also maybe falling into that. But we haven't gotten as far as studying sort of robot-pet interaction of any sort.
Hi, a lot of coordination happens with humans with voice, like we talk to each other. And in robotics as well, there are a lot of voice recognition software like Siri or Alexa and so on. Do you consider that as part of your research, that it's not just augmented reality, but also voice comes in the way?
Yeah, maybe I'll take that. So we've actually had amazing progress in the last 10, 15 years in the accuracy of speech recognition. And there was just a study that came out very recently in the last couple of months for a previous faculty here at Berkeley, Professor James Landay, who showed that voice recognition in some settings can now outperform typing, for example, on a smartphone. Now, there are a couple of hurdles, though, that I think will prevent voice recognition from being a ubiquitous technology. One is planning your utterance. Like, thinking about what it is you will say is not a trivial task in itself. And the other one is that when you then make a mistake, correcting a mistake, maybe a mistake, you said the wrong thing, you had a slip, or there was an error in the recognition, correcting a mistake through more voice commands is very time intensive and taxing. So it's, you know, it is much easier in some ways when you look at a word processor and you type a sentence and you see something is wrong, you can backspace or move the caret and edit it in place. That facility doesn't exist if you're only working with voice. All you can do is say more things, and that makes recovering from errors pretty costly with voice input. And that's why, you know, voice input for dictation works very well right now. In other areas, I think what we'll see is a complementary, you know, multimodal input where you couple voice where it's good with, you know, high precision tactile input, wherever that is good at.
If I can, I want to just add to what Björn was saying to actually reply to your question. Is that another thing that, you know, I think the industry and also the academia has come to realize actually is that, you know, when you actually try to do speech recognition and so on and so forth, and we need to think about, you know, what's the end goal? I think the end goal is through speech to communicate, to interact. So I think people found out actually is that any single modality, including either gesture or voice or some other kind of interaction, will not be self-contained. So you need to actually put everything right, because, you know, our sensors that we have developed actually, you know, understood by our brain is so delicate that actually have been evolved thousands of years. If there's a tiny glitch that in your, you know, recreation of virtualization or augmentation doesn't actually fit the traditional way that we interact with the people, including speech by other ways, and then we will pick up, and then we will realize that, oh, this is not real. So in addition to speech and all the other sensors, all the other sensings have to make sense, have to be put together as a holistic solution.
Hi, I'm a new student at the Haas Evening and Weekend MBA program, And I was wondering, what level of coordination do you guys have with the business school, and or are there opportunities for coordination?
Okay, so I mentioned, so in our CSC center, we're actually collaborating with business professors. One of them actually is Lee Flemming. So he is, I think the managing director of Coleman Fung Institute for entrepreneurship innovation. So definitely you could actually talk to Professor Flemming. We're actually thinking about how to further tighten the connection between the College of Engineering and Business School, because there are so many things we can do. In addition to just educating students to be entrepreneurs and so on and so forth, we can actually study how the new market of AR and VR, if you could say that, will evolve, and what are the pros and cons of different companies approaching AR and VR in different ways and so on and so forth. And also want to tie that back to the Master of Engineering program that we are developing. That traditionally, if you go to a Haas Business School, you are looking for an MBA degree. So the MBA degree mostly actually are for managerial type of role. But if you are an engineer, so you are a technical track, but you also want to get some experience how to do a in-house entrepreneur and so on and so forth in big companies, and then probably a Master of Engineering program will be a good choice for you.
I have maybe one other take on that, and that is just want to make sure everyone knows that the Jacobs Institute for Design Innovation, while at home in the College of Engineering, is open to students from all across campus. So you are just as welcome as any other student from any other department, and we'll have specific workshops and called design nights over the course of the semester that you can use to get introduced to some of the equipment and the capabilities we have there without having to take an engineering class.
So we talked a lot about human interaction with robots, but has there been research done in like critical mass or tipping point for like autonomous interactions in a mixed human environment? Like what I'm thinking of is traffic issues, and if you have a critical mass of vehicles, when does that basically alleviate traffic problems for human drivers? And has there been research into kind of when that tipping point is, or how that comes about?
Right. There's definitely in the transportation world, people worry a lot about this. So, for instance, our colleague Alex Bayon has a lot of research on that, and the sort of the multi agent coordination where you have a mixed team. The highlights are if you have all fully autonomous, then you're good. If you have fully autonomous but from different companies and they haven't agreed on standards, there might still be issues. Humans mess everything up because you have to start predicting what they're going to do, and all these coordination problems arise. And it doesn't seem feasible that we'll go sort of directly to a fully autonomous world. So it looks like we have to deal with some of these coordination issues. Yeah.
One of the issues that we're facing now in greater numbers is problems with the elderly and the disabled. Can you show how some of your technology, particularly in robot understanding your real needs, could be used for forming some of the simple tasks, such as helping prevent people from falling, or simply clearing up the table after you've eaten so that you can live independently longer?
That's an excellent question, yeah. And actually, a big focus in our lab is actually on assistive robotics. So the main platforms that we work on are, there's assistive arms that are mounted on your, can be mounted on your wheelchair that can help you if you have motor impairments, either because of an accident, like a spinal cord injury, or because you're becoming more elderly. It can act as an arm that you are sort of shared the autonomy with it, and it's trying to be smart about figuring out what you want to do so that it can actually help you with these day-to-day tasks, like getting a glass of water or something like that. And then, of course, there are also these sort of home robots, personal robots that can help just clear up the table or something, or hold up something as you're you know, basically take the weight or do the help you do these things that as you age, maybe you won't be able to do independently anymore. So I think aging in place is a big, and also empowering people to be more independent and not rely on caregivers for absolutely everything are definitely goals that I think robotics over the longer term can really contribute to.
Yeah, I want to make a quick plug here for Enable Tech. This is an undergraduate student run club that focuses on building technology, assistive technology. And they're meeting every week in Jacobs Hall. And I think there's also a continuum from, you know, very complex, high degree of freedom robots that can help you with many tasks because they're a general purpose platform. Mm-hmm. And you'll also see very specific products emerging that may be single purpose, but therefore more affordable, maybe hitting the market earlier. So for example, a recent example that a Berkeley undergraduate worked on a team at a startup is a fork that compensates for tremor you may have in your hand. So you can continue eating without any of the food inadvertently falling off of the fork. So it's kind of like motion stabilization that you use in Hollywood for cameras applied to utensils. A really fantastic product.
I just want to add another thing is that we have another faculty member here, Professor Rujana Baichi, and she actually was the former director of Citrus, the building in here. And her lab has been doing telemedicine and tele-emergence for 10 years, and then in some of the interesting application, it's not mainly in robotics, but how about putting the information about a patient long distance? You know, some elderly people, they may not easily travel to hospitals to do rehabilitation, to do diagnosis with the information, the medical information in the hospital. So I think that in virtual reality and augmented reality, you can actually combine the two together, and then you can design some very, very interesting applications in the augmented telemedicine.
Yes, I had a question as far as the actual VR and AR effect on human civilization, because we're going to lose our motivation and physical capability of solving day-to-day problems because we're going to be leaving it to the machine and all this. If anybody's doing any kind of studies on a long-term effect, thank you.
I think that's a great question. Right now, actually, if you look at the prediction from Wall Street, we are on the West Coast, but if you look at the prediction from Wall Street and the industry of AR and VR, so they are saying actually the applications from augmented reality will be watching much, much bigger pie versus virtual reality. I think part of the reason actually was what you mentioned is because if you just occlude people's field of view and then put people in a chair and then getting people to be lazy and so on and so forth, actually the amount of information, the amount of market actually will be much, much less than augmented reality. In augmented reality, actually what you want actually is not making you lazy. It's actually bringing the information to you more dynamically, more contextual based, which means that you wear see-through glasses while you are still doing the tasks that the computer can actively help you. So I think in that sense, so that's the reason people saying that augmented reality actually is better than virtual reality. Part of the concern was actually what you just mentioned. And in terms of the long-term study, I think we are still in the infancy of explaining that, of discovering that problem. So I just mentioned about augmented telemedicine. So in that case, if you put people, especially kids, in an augmented and virtual reality environment, can we actually do more harm to the people or can we do more good to the people? And we still don't know. So this is actually an unknown question.
Similarly for robotics, I think you can definitely make an argument for how having these sort of assistive robots will enable you to do tasks, to keep on doing the tasks that you normally do, that without these robots or without caregivers, you wouldn't be able to actually do anymore. So, something that holds something for you that you can no longer lift, but you're still contributing to the task. But at the same time, I think there is definitely a danger that, will the same technology can be used for robots to fetch you a beer from the fridge and you just sit on your couch, right? So, technology, I think, for the longest time has been a double-edged sword, and I think we definitely have to be careful about how we might use these tools to incentivize people to do more physical activity and contribute more, as opposed to, you know, could replace what they do, and so have them do less. I think that's a really important point.
Very, very good. At this point, we've come pretty much to the end of the time that we have available. This has been just fantastic discussion, and I wish we could keep on going, but let's thank our speakers. And so, you know, Berkeley truly is an amazing place, and I think everybody's going to really enjoy this wonderful homecoming weekend. The next thing we recommend is over at the Jacobs Institute for Design Innovation. We do have the Virtual Reality at Berkeley student group. And please take the time to go and stop by there as well and enjoy that. And enjoy the rest of this weekend, everybody. Go Bears!